Hi, and welcome to the Coit Bay National Estuary and Research Reserve. I'm Max, and I am one of the park interpreters here. At the reserve, we perform research to help us better understand the marine coastal ecosystem. Today, we're going to be talking about a very special guest, the osprey, who appears here at Coit Bay every summer. In the winter, they will migrate down south, and then again next summer, they will come back up north to the east coast. They are a bird of prey, also known as a raptor or a hunting bird, and they have very special adaptations that help them do what they're best at, which is hunting. Along with their adaptations today, we're going to be talking about the life cycle and the food web. So come along with me and I'll teach you all you need to know. This is an osprey and they can measure up to 6 feet. However, they were not actually this large in size. Like all other birds, ospreys begin as a little chick that comes from one of these eggs, which is pretty similar to what they actually look like. And they will grow to be from about a fifth of a pound to that large size that they are, which is about 6-7 pounds maybe. Every year, the female will lay anywhere between 2 to 3 eggs. So the parents will incubate the eggs for about 4 to 5 weeks, which will be 30 to 40 days. And once they hatch, they are called nestlings. And for ospreys in particular, they are born with full down and their eyes are actually open. This is a nestling right here. And it will take them about 5 to 6 weeks in order to reach the stage of a fledgling, which in this diagram, it is actually only it is actually 8 weeks old, but it will get to be that size very soon. And as you can see here, between being a nestling and a fledgling, they have this super fast growth period where they almost gain a third of their weight within just a few days, which is really, really interesting because that's very fast, especially compared to humans. We take about 20 years to get to our full size. But so they had this, since they are migratory birds, they need to hit this super fast period so that they can be able to leave when it comes to winter time. As the fledglings grow and learn how to become better flyers, they will also practice their landing skills and they will also return to the nest to keep being fed by their parents. They will not learn to fish on their own until they have fully mastered how to fly and get themselves up out of the water. As time passes and the fledgling learns how to fish, they will become independent, which signifies that they have become a full adult. This is a migration pattern actually tracked by an organization who was following a bunch of birds all around the country, and this individual one was actually right here on Martha's Vineyard. And as you can see, she goes from up here in New England all the way down along the coast, eventually going from Florida through the Caribbean islands over to South America, and then they can spread out anywhere in there. Even though they will migrate south for the winter, beginning at late summer, they will also return in the spring to come back north in order to breed again. Once the birds find their mate, they are actually a monogamous pair, which means that they will mate with each other for their life. The lifespan of an osprey can be up to 25 years old for females and 20 years old for males. And then the cycle will repeat to start a new generation. this is a diagram of the osprey, also known, as you can see, as the pendion helioitis. Other given names are the fish hawk, river hawk, and sea hawk. From this representation, you can tell that the bird is very enormous. Even though 6 feet is on the larger size of their wingspan range, the average wingspan will be about 5 feet. So even though this is a little larger than normal, you can still tell it's a huge bird. Starting with our adaptations, the first one we will do is the shape of the wings. As you can see, they are in an M shape, or an arch-like figure, which allows them to cut through the air, being more aerodynamically efficient, and the fact that their wings are so large, they can easily float above the surface of the water while they're waiting for prey to appear. Feathers of the bird that line the wings are going to be our next topic, and they are so important because they have a special kind of oil that keeps them water resistant. What that means is when the bird dives in to the water and gets covered, it does not soak into their skin nor their feathers, allowing them to be able to pull themselves out of the water. Each fiber on the feather has a hook on it that allows it to connect with the one next to it. This helps keep them together and all neat, because if not, they would just start to fray, which means to pull apart, and the bird would not be as efficient at keeping its aerodynamic capabilities. Now we're going to talk about the talons. The osprey has 4 long toes, also known as talons, which are highly adapted for the environment in which you catch a lot of slippery foods, otherwise known as fish. So the first adaptation is that they are very, very long. So they provide optimal grip on the fish itself and can use their opposable fourth toe instead of as a normal raptor who uses 3 in front and 1 in back. They can put their third toe in front to behind in order to put 2 on one side and 2 on the other side of the fish, also increasing the efficiency of their grip. And the final interesting part about the way they carry the fish is instead of carrying it sideways like most raptors, they will carry it in a line parallel to their body. Because as you can see, if the wind is hitting such a large face like this, it will cause a lot of force to be put that is unnecessary for the bird while carrying food back to the nest. To get a better hold on the fish, the osprey also has very tiny spikes that line the talons, which create more points of contact along the fish. Since fish is their main food source and is very slippery, having a better hold on it will only increase their chances of catching. Like most hawks, is hooked, and it allows it to easily consume the fish that it catches. With that, as the bird is fishing, it needs a way to protect its nose, which actually leads to its adaptation of a nasal valve, which, as the bird is hunting, it will dive and fully submerge into the water, and involuntarily, the valve will seal and keep the bird from getting water into its nose. Ospreys are known as bird of prey, which means that they are at the top of the food chain. As you can see here, that's the bird. And then their sole food source is actually these fish. If there is a shortage of fish, they have been known to expand their diet to mammals, reptiles, and other birds. Since they are tertiary consumers at the top of the food chain here, they are known to have very little predators other than, say, a raccoon who will come and eat its eggs, or other birds of prey such as great horned owls, bald eagles, or even other osprey who will prey upon the chicks and the eggs of an unattended nest. At the bottom of the food chain is the primary producers, which means anything that photosynthesizes, just like plants and algae, contribute to the bottom of the food chain. And they are eaten by animals and creatures known as herbivores. Herbivores eat plants and algae because they are the second link in the food chain. And above them comes these small planktivorous fish, which means that their main food source is plankton, which could either be zoo or phytoplankton. But that's why plankton are so important, because they are necessarily the bottom of the food chain for actual moving creatures. Next comes the secondary consumers, and in this food chain pertaining to the osprey, the secondary consumer is a large piscivorous fish, which means being a piscivore is one who feeds on solely a fish diet. So here at the end of the food chain we have our osprey, who is actually another piscivore, because its only food source are these large fish that it can catch from the water. Sadly, in about the 1950s, early 1960s, there was a chemical created called DDT. It was mainly trying to get rid of mosquitoes, but sadly, it did not only affect the mosquitoes, it also got into the water supply. And the osprey actually suffered very greatly from this, because the DDT was being consumed by the base layer animals and plants such as the phytoplankton, which was then eaten by the small planktivorous fish and zooplankton. So then it started to build up in both of those parts of the food chain, and then it ended up getting to the large piscivorous fish, because they were feeding on every other creature that had it already in its system. And then by the end, the ospreys had been eating these large piscivorous fish with such a large buildup of DDT that it was killing the baby eggs of the ospreys, and their shells weren't strong enough to support being incubated, so they were actually being crushed by their parents. And there was a ban on DDT in around, I believe, the late 1960s, early 70s, which did not permit it to be used in any environments. So luckily after that, the ospreys are, since they have such great adaptations, they were able to come back so quickly and so strongly in numbers that now the Cape is filled with them, when at once there was almost only one or two breeding pairs on all of Cape Cod. Due to our recent efforts of, say, banning the use of DDT and putting up all of these posts around coastal areas, the osprey have now come back in a huge boom to take their place back as the top of the food chain. Now that you have learned about the osprey, you can see how wonderful these birds truly are. If you ever want to see some osprey action in person, come head down to the Wacoit Bay National Estuarine Research Reserve. We'll be waiting for you.